Woman Jacker. Welcome to the Melbourne International Comedy Festival. We acknowledge that we are on the traditional lands of the Kulin Nation. We pay our respect to elders past, present and emerging. We acknowledge the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people's spirit, imagination and rich history of storytelling and humour that is an inspiration for all Australians.
All right, here we go, Thursday night. Can you guys please clap your hands together? Get a bit of clapping going, a bit of cheering, a bit louder. Yeah, that's good. And welcome to the stage, Lewis Garnham. Woo, yeah!
Woo! I never know how long to sit in that song for. Part of me is like, should I just let the whole song play? It's a good track. Another part of me is like, I feel very uncomfortable. Thank you for coming to my show. Give yourselves a round of applause for being here. How cool is this? A couple months ago, I thought that this show, I was like, I won't even be able to do this festival. It won't be on. And now, look, it's happening. It's happened at this point. It ends on Sunday. It's occurred. Festival's occurred. Give yourselves another round of applause. Fuck it, we did it. How good's that? We beat the virus, sort of. And on coming out of that big lockdown, I was in Melbourne during that big lockdown. I realised after that I hate all my interstate friends. I don't know if anyone else had that. I never thought I'd be patriotic about the city that I live in, but that big lockdown made that happen. Because like I grew up in Adelaide, so during that big lockdown, I was talking to a lot of my friends on the phone from back in Adelaide. Remember that? Talking to your interstate friends during that big lockdown? Insensitive pricks, aren't they? I hate them. Remember that on the phone? Hey, mate, yeah, just at the pub. More crowded, if anything. Fuck you. No masks, all good. Why? What are you up to? What have you been doing? Surely you know nothing. Surely, have you seen the news? I've been for a walk. Legally, that's all I can do. You must know that. Sorry, mate, yeah, pretty crazy over here. Sorry, bit drunk, bit hammered, pretty wild over here. Just got off a mechanical bull. How the fuck are you doing mechanical bulls while I'm living in this reality? They were unhygienic and unnecessary before the pandemic, surely. Stupid invention. I was in Adelaide a few weeks ago. I was still annoyed at them. I was still pissed off. I was in Adelaide a few weeks ago. I was there for 5 days. As soon as I got there, I was licking door handles. Fuck them. Coughing on people. Who cares? I went to all the Melbourne hotspots before I left. Just hung out in them. Went to Chadstone. I was touching everything. Whatever. Got to Adelaide sneezing on trains. Who gives a shit? Went to so many restaurants, didn't check in. I told him my phone was broken. Sorry, mate, my phone's broken. It wasn't. I just didn't want to. They deserve it. The last day I was there, my plan was the final day that I was in Adelaide, I was going to call the Chief Health Officer of South Australia and just be like, hey, mate, I'm really sorry. I've been in your city for 5 days. I've got COVID. I don't know, just make it up. Who cares? Lock these people down, you know? Pull the trigger. I hope they like puzzles. Fuck them. It wasn't fair, was it? It was so unfair. Bet you got a lot done, though. I hated that. A lot of them said that. I was unemployed throughout most of that lockdown. You would have got a lot done. All that time, every cloud, silver lining, you would have got a lot done. You would have been very productive. That's good, isn't it? A lot of writing, a lot of comedy writing. You would have written a lot. That's nice, isn't it? Look at the positives. Fuck you. Don't put pressure on me like that. No, I didn't. I didn't do anything. I didn't get anything done. I tried to be really productive every day of that big lockdown. I sat down and said, yep, today I'm going to be productive. I'm going to do writing. I procrastinated more than I ever have in my life. One day I found myself Googling procrastination. That's sad, isn't it? How ironic is that? Googling the causes and effects of procrastination instead of doing what I was supposed to be doing. There's like studies that have been done on procrastination. I found that quite interesting. Like people have researched it extensively. Like people have procrastinated and then reported back on their findings. I don't envy that job. That's a rabbit hole and a half, isn't it? Hey, Jack, how are you going with that procrastination research? To be honest, mate, I've just been watching videos of cats on YouTube. So you haven't been doing what you're supposed to be doing, which technically means you have been procrastinating. Well done. Keep it up. Although the fact that you have been procrastinating means you've been doing exactly what you should be doing, which hence means you haven't been procrastinating and therefore haven't been doing what you should have been doing, which then means, like I said, I didn't do a lot of writing during lockdown. This is the rest of the show. feel like in Adelaide, they didn't take it seriously from the beginning. They never had to take it seriously. I was in Adelaide when it all started, COVID all started. Remember that 2 week period where like around the country, everyone was like, okay, this is actually quite serious now. I was in Adelaide then, March last year, and I was sitting outside a pub. I couldn't believe this. I couldn't believe just how nonchalant they were about it in Adelaide. I was sitting outside a pub with a few friends. We'd just found out that the Melbourne Comedy Festival was getting cancelled, so we were sort of drowning our sorrows, talking about that, talking about COVID, talking about the end of the world. Remember that stage when it was just like, we don't know what's going to happen. Is the world ending? That's what everyone was thinking. We're sitting there having all those thoughts, right? Picture that. We're out in front of this pub thinking all that stuff. And then I look over and I see and hear very loudly, you know those silent discos? You know those people? At a time like that, can you imagine that? It's like 100 of them marching down the street. Can you feel it? Woo! Can you feel it? That's what they were singing. How dystopic's that? Can you feel it? Yeah. It feels like a plague. I can feel it. It feels like a recession. I felt like I couldn't be that upset about the Melbourne Comedy Festival getting cancelled because obviously there was a lot of shit things happening in the world at that time. And also, everything was getting cancelled. Like, nothing was exempt from it. So I felt like I couldn't really feel that bad. The women's AFL got cancelled 1 week before the grand final. How brutal is that? Getting ready for the grand final, cancelled. I've been watching a lot of the women's AFL lately in the last few weeks. It's been back on TV. And I want it to get to the same point as the male AFL. I want it to be the exact same, on field, off field. I think that would be a crazy mark of how much it country can change if in the near future the AFLW was exactly the same as the AFL. I want the same things to be happening. On the field, off the field, same thing going on, stories taking place. I want to get to the stage where you turn on the news and the newsreader's like, vision has emerged of three women from the West Coast Eagles snorting lines of white powder off of an unconscious man's testicles as he slept in a Gold Coast apartment earlier this week. They will be receiving a 3-match suspension, so pretty harsh punishment for sexual assault. Quite harsh. People will be arguing about it. There'll be different scandals every week, other things going on. People will argue about it. Oh, is that the right thing? Oh, what are they doing? Why are they on social media, people will argue. Some people will say this is toxic femininity. Other people will say girls will be girls, let them play, it's all good. I think there'll be one player in particular. I'm picturing her. I don't know why, but I'm picturing that her name is going to be Ellie Wanker. Her last name's Wanker. That's funny. People joke about that. But she's a great player, right? She's an absolute superstar. The commentators, when she gets the ball, they call her E Wanker. Oh, E Wanker's got the ball. People give her nicknames. E Wanker. People call her Wanker E. Wanker E. Wankery. Whatever they call her. Anyway. She'll have a big career. She'll leave the league. When she leaves, she'll get involved in a bit of scandal, bit of domestic violence. Who knows? Everyone knows she's done some domestic violence. She'll disappear for a while, but a few years later, she'll sort of just start worming her way back into the media. At first, everyone will be like, I don't know about that, wankery. That's a bit weird. But after a while, everyone will just be like, yeah, that's fine. She'll be on Channel 7 every second night, and everyone will be like, yeah, I think that's okay for some reason. Some people will be like, didn't she try to glass her boyfriend? Yeah, but it was ages ago. And she's a great player. She's the queen. She's an absolute gun. Knows a lot about the game. It'll get to the tipping point for me. It'll be International Men's Day of all fucking days. It'll be the International Men's Round, the Blue Ribbon Round, and she'll be on a panel with three other women, and she'll give a speech before the game about violence against men like she's got any fucking clue what she's talking about. And on that day, I'll think to myself, wow, this country's come a long way. I'll be so proud. Before COVID even, it was such a crazy year. I was so amazed by how quickly the media that we consume, how quickly that can change. Even the advice that we consume, like advice around the country, it can change so drastically, so drastically. March last year, the bushfires are over. Everyone telling us, politicians, media, everyone. And it was good advice. Everyone's saying, go to the southeast coast, go to East Gippsland, go to the pubs, go to as many places as you can. Get all your friends, go to a restaurant, pack it out, get sweaty, dance all night. Stay in really close proximity to each other. The next day, it was like, stay the fuck inside. Don't touch anything. Don't shake anyone's hand. ScoMo could have used that advice 2 months prior, interestingly. That's interesting because Scott Morrison tried to shake a few hands. No one wanted to do it. And then everyone just decided to never shake hands again. What a weird premonition. It's like the thought of shaking his hand is so gross that we were all just like, let's never risk it. Let's just ban it entirely. I felt quite sad during the bushfires. I felt like sad, scared. I'm sure a lot of people would have felt that. That's not unique. But I also felt during that time, I felt quite inspired, because around that time, that was the first time in my life where I'd seen so many people protesting for climate action. Around that time, there was thousands of people marching all over the world protesting for climate action. Huge rallies going on. In Melbourne, massive marches. There was a march in Melbourne for climate action. They reckon there was 100,000 people there. That's what they said. I wasn't there. I had stuff on, but I still appreciated it. I can feel you all judging me, a bit judgmental. Yeah, whatever. Firstly, have a look at this. I'm not bragging, but I know you're a bit judgmental about me missing the rally. Have a look at this. This is, I don't know if you can read that at the back, but that's eco-friendly cigarette filters. All got to do our part, don't we? Felt quite guilty about missing the rally, which is why since then I've just been fucking chaining darts. I don't know what they do, but they're eco-friendly. I figure if I smoke enough, I can turn this thing around, you know what I mean? Went down to St Kilda the other day, poured a few packets in the ocean. I think that's good. They're eco-friendly. I was feeding them to seagulls. They love them. You've probably noticed. You've probably been walking around. Oh, there's more trees around. The grass looks greener. That's me doing that. I'm having 70 a day. My lungs are in agony. Just by a round of applause, does anyone else use eco-friendly cigarette filters? Never is. Never is. They're under the reefs, fucked. Come on, guys. Put some effort in. Some of you are probably sitting there, oh, but I don't even smoke. Start fucking smoking then. The climate clock is ticking. My friend said this to me. I think this is one of the stupidest things I've ever heard in my life. He said, you shouldn't use condoms because the material that condoms are made out of, it's not biodegradable. It never breaks down. It ends up eventually in the ocean and then fish end up choking on it. So you shouldn't use condoms for that reason. Firstly, I assume that doesn't work in the bedroom, that line. I doubt any of his sexual partners are like, fuck, you're such an environmentalist. Good point, take it off. But also, that's such an illogical argument. That doesn't make any sense. Like, think about the purpose of condoms. If humans are the ones causing ecological disaster, more condoms equals less humans. Condoms are the best thing for the environment regardless of what they're made of. Who cares? Make them out of whatever. Make them out of seals, whales, who gives a shit? Depleted uranium, it doesn't matter. They'll always be the best thing for the environment. More condoms equals less humans. More condoms, if you think about it, eventually equals less condoms, doesn't it? So, they're our best defense against themselves. If you want a world with less condoms, start using a fucking condom. That would be my advice. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with having kids. A lot of my friends are having kids. That's cool. Good on them. I think that's great. I'm happy that people are having kids. I'm happy that people have had kids in the past. My parents, for example, quite happy about that. That was a cool decision. I rate that. Happy I got to live, have a life, have a childhood. I had like a very happy, lucky, privileged childhood. I had like one big event in my childhood, and it wasn't even bad. I became deaf in my left ear when I was 8 years old. Not even a big deal. Not a bad thing either. Like, I remember thinking at the time, this is better. This is definitely an improvement. Quite a substantial improvement. And to this day, I stand by that. I think there's a serious flaw with double ears. I think double ears is wrong. I've got like a superpower. I've got a mute button. I can choose what I want to hear in life with so much more ease than everyone else. So good. Someone's snoring next to me, I can just roll onto my good ear, blissful silence. How's that? Roadworks on the street, no worries. Kick-ons back at my house, have more people around. I don't give a fuck. I'm on this ear. Turn the music up. That works for anything that you don't want to hear in life. Any sort of thing that you might not want to hear in life. You could be at a party, someone starts telling you what star sign they are. You can lean up against a wall. Oh, Sagittarius, do go on, Jacob. That sounds great. Please explain more. Dream stories. Correct? Dream stories. When I said dream stories just then, if you were like, what do you mean? What's wrong with hearing about dream stories? This part of the show is for you. You need to listen to this. This is important. You need to be made aware of how much the rest of us fucking hate your dream stories. Stop telling us your dream stories. For the rest of us, the worst sentence in the English language is, guess what happened in my dream last night? It fills us all with dread. How narcissistic that you assume we're going to be so keen to hear what took place in your subconscious while you were sleeping, that we're going to guess, that we're going to not even listen to the story, we're going to jump in with a guess. Can I guess? Can I jump in with a guess? Oh my God, I've got a few things in mind, but I'm going to go with, at the last minute, you were in the woods and then a teacher from your primary school came in. Fuck! What an ending! What a climax! It's like a movie that got written and then they were like, let's never make it. It's shit. It didn't happen. Don't tell me about something that never happened. I think, I have a theory, I think that skydiving stories are the only stories as bad as dream stories. Like, if you've been skydiving, well done. I'm sure it was very exhilarating, very exciting. But we don't care because we all know like 7 or 8 people that have been skydiving, right? So we've heard that story 7 or 8 times. And that story is the exact same every time you hear it. It has to be because there's so many safety procedures that have to be meticulously followed. There's no room for any difference within that story. We all know the skydiving story. It's the same every time. We got there, the plane was flying up. As the plane was leveling out, I did have a moment where I was like, oh my God. Oh my, can I do this? Like, can I? I thought I could, but now that I'm here, I don't know. I'm not so sure. But the instructor, John, he was great. He looked at me, he said, Jess, you've got this. You've got this, babe. He grabbed me. We just jumped out. It sounds crazy, but he was like, we're just doing it. He didn't even wait for me to, like, chime in. So we just jumped. And then that feeling when you're falling, holy shit. So hard to describe. It's just so hard to describe it back, especially because you haven't done it. It's just so hard to describe it back. But it's like, you know in your logical brain, I've got a parachute, there's systems in place, I'm going to be okay. But there is another part of your brain that's like, oh my God, I might die. Like, I could die. I wish you had. Then your story would be interesting. Like, a skydiving story can only be interesting if something goes wrong. That's the only way it can differ from all the others. If you're not in a wheelchair, shut the fuck up about skydiving. Ironically, the only people with good skydiving stories probably can't talk anymore. That's sad, isn't it? Probably the whole reason they went. There was one bad thing about being deaf in my left ear. This is the only negative I've been able to find in my whole life. When I was about 10 years old, this is the only bad thing about being deaf in my left ear. When I was about 10 years old, I got an iPod for my birthday, and I didn't realise at the time that headphones don't distribute equal parts of the song through each headphone. I thought it was the same part, 50% amplification, 50% amp. It's different bits. This one's got the bass, this one's got the treble, different instruments, different lyrics come through on each. I was just walking around listening to my iPod. Honestly, for the first 10 years of me hearing it, I only heard the high parts in Bohemian Rhapsody. And everyone's like, yeah, it's the greatest song of all time. I'm like, yeah, but there's a lot of gaps. Like, Galileo, and then put something after that, surely. Stupid. I'm just a poor boy, nobody loves me. I never even knew that he was from a poor family. Should ask your family for some cash, Fred. They've got money as far as I know. Over the last few years, I've been working, like alongside doing stand-up, I've been working in schools, work as a teacher's aide at different schools, been working at a bunch of schools, and I really like working with kids. I mostly work with primary school age kids, and I like it. I like it because kids say stuff that causes you to reflect on your own life. I was talking to a kid recently, and he said this thing to me. He was sitting across the other side of the room, right? He's 5 years old, this kid. And I went over to him because I saw that he was crying. He was crying. And as I got closer, I realized this kid's not just crying. Sometimes they just cry for no reason. Just whatever, I'll just have a cry. This didn't look like that. He was like shaking. He had tears all over his face. He looked really, really devastated. I started getting worried. I went over to him. I was like, what's happened? I nearly said his name just then. I shouldn't do that. I'll call him Bob because that's his name backwards. I said, Bob, what? Stupid joke. That's my favourite part of the show, and it's no one else's, but it is genuinely my favourite part. I said to him, mate, what's wrong? What's happened? Why are you crying this much? What's going on? And he looked up at me. He had tears all over his face, so earnest. He looked up at me. He picked up this pile of Lego that he'd been working on, 5 years old. He looked up at me, showed me the Lego, tears running down his face. He said, I've just built the worst train that I've ever built. How beautiful is that? How naive. Imagine if that was the scale of your problems. Like, that's his biggest problem at that point in his life. That's his biggest drama. Isn't that incredible? That's beautiful, isn't it? But also, if that is your biggest problem, life's going to be a fucking roller coaster, isn't it, Bob? It's going to be a wild ride. Like, imagine when Bob goes through a breakup. Imagine that, Bob. Imagine that. You're building that train. Every day you're working on that train tirelessly, adding blocks. Oh, can we build it? Can we fix it? The train starts to get a little bit derailed. You start thinking, oh, maybe if we change the train a bit, maybe if it's not like a monogamous train, maybe if every now and then other passengers get on just for a bit, a station or two, then they hop off. Maybe that'll fix the train. Turns out the blocks you were using to build that train, they never matched up in the beginning, did they, Bob? Those blocks were never meant to fit together. And then I started crying. They cause you to reflect on your own life. I love that about kids. I love that. I've just built the worst train I've ever built. When do you lose that naivety? I think, like, for most people, that gets broken down as you become aware of the harsh realities of the world. For me, it was three distinct phases. It was like realizing that adults can lie. They lie to you, and they do lie to you. And then realizing, more specifically, my parents lie to me. And then finally, realizing my heroes, my childhood heroes, even they're flawed, and even they lie. For me, they were the three things that stripped me of that naivety that I think we all sort of start off with and we all lose as we grow older. Another thing we start off with and lose as we grow older, and I love this one, is like young kids haven't, there's not a word for it, they haven't lived in a society for long enough to learn social etiquette. So they're not aware of what they should and shouldn't say. They have no concept of it. As a result, they speak with pure honesty, proper pure honesty, and it's the best. I was talking to a girl recently, she's 8 years old, and she was trying to ask me how old I am. I could tell that was what she was trying to ask, but she couldn't figure out how to articulate the sentence. She was kind of dancing around it. She was like, how many ages, what are the ages of your birth? At what is it? At the year of your birth, when is the age of your... And then eventually she was just like, when are you going to die? Pure honesty. That's what we're all really asking when we ask that question, isn't it? It's beautiful. I love that. I feel like young kids don't really give that much of a shit about death. They talk about it like it's nothing. You're like, why shouldn't we run inside with scissors? Because we'll fall over, stab ourselves and die. You're like, whoa, I wasn't really going for that angle, but okay, good example. They talk about death like it's nothing. They're so blasé about it. And then also, like, really old people are the same. They talk about death like it's nothing at the end of your life. It's only in the middle period that we get all trepidatious about talking about death. Like, my grandpa, before he passed away, he said something that'll always stick with me. I went to visit him, and he said this. He said, first he said, Lewis, I want to show you something. And he took me into his bathroom. I was like, I don't like that. That's the setting. For you showing me something, Grandpa. Doesn't seem right. But then he pointed at the ground, so blasé about death. He points at the ground and he says, look at that. What am I looking at, Grandpa? Look at that. Have a look at that. Usually I get the packet of 24 toilet rolls, but this time I got the 12 pack because I figured it should probably see me out. No point wasting 12 rolls, is there, Grandpa? You're not going to leave them behind in the will. That'd be weird. They'll just go to waste. Isn't it crazy that that's what our lives come down to? Like, at the end of life, that's what you're doing. You have this crazy life, you do all these things. At the end of your life, that's how you're spending your time, just guessing. Like, you live your life, you do so many things, there's so much magic in life. You're a kid. Oh, the magic. Is Father Christmas real? You know, you learn how to do the swings for the first time without needing an adult to push you. That's magic. You get a little bit older. You're a teenager. You do drugs for the first time. That's magic. You get a bit older. You start looking at the world in a bigger way, like more than just your little bubble. You start looking at the whole world. You start having heroes. You start having icons. You see, like, Obama give a speech at the UN. You're like, I love that guy. He's my hero. I'm inspired by that guy. You start thinking, maybe I could change the world. Maybe I could be a positive force in this world. You get a little bit older, you get a job, you start working 5 days a week, hour commute each way, you get a bit tired. The enthusiasm, the keenness, it kind of gets sapped out of you by capitalism over a period of years and years and years. Some good things happen, of course. You fall in love, but after a while, the magic dies. A few years later, so does she, and then you're alone. At the end of your life, just in Coles, aisle 9, just going, how many more shits am I going to take? I want to nail this. I want to nail my shit for sheet ratio because it's my last little game on earth. That's my magic now. That's the magic I've got left at this stage. Isn't that wild? And he died before COVID. I'm so glad that he didn't live to see COVID. Because if that's the magic, if that's the last little game at that stage in your life, imagine how hard the last year's been for older individuals. Not only does the virus affect you disproportionately, you also have to watch much younger people greedily hoard the one thing that still brings you joy. That's their magic. Some people believe that your childhood plays a great role in forming you into the adult that you become. Some people believe that. I think it's all star signs, to be honest. Whatever star sign you are, that's the most determining factor. I mentioned star signs before. I'm not a big fan of them. I'm not that into star signs. A lot of people are quite into it, quite into astrology. It's very in right now. I don't know if you've noticed that. It's very cool. It's very in vogue. It's very hip. I liked it when it was niche. I liked it when it was a bit more obscure. That was good. Remember that? 10 years ago, just your weird auntie in Bendigo, she'd talk about it. That was great. What's happened since then? Kim Kardashian tweeted about it or something. Everyone loves it now. You hear people on the street, oh, I'd never date a Scorpio. Fuck that. I'd never. So passionate. Talk about it like it's a religion or a science. It's neither. I don't know what it is, but it's neither. Even right now, I can feel this is not a popular opinion to have. Especially in this city, Melbourne, the mecca of pseudoscience. People hate me saying this. I can feel right now a lot of the crowd's pretty angry. 60% of you are sitting there like, ah, I bet he's a fucking Gemini, isn't he? I'm sorry, I just think people take it a bit too seriously. I overheard this in a cafe recently. I was at this cafe in Clifton Hill. I overheard this guy talking to his friends. He's sitting there, he's wearing a suit at this cafe in Clifton Hill. He's talking to his friends and he's going, yeah, I just always order charcuterie boards. It's so weird. I just always seem to be ordering charcuterie boards. I think it's because I'm a Pisces, so I'm really indecisive. What the fuck, mate? I think it's because you're a lawyer and you have disposable income. It's not superstitious. You've got enough cash to pay for a weird meal that doesn't really fill you up. That's all it is, mate. Don't read into it so much. Some people think I'm dissing the moon. I'm not dissing the moon. I love the moon. I got a lot of respect for the moon. I've always rated the moon, rate the moon very highly. The moon does all sorts of shit. We're all aware. It does crazy stuff. The tides, wow, amazing. There's coral in the ocean, right? Coral spawns once a year. It spawns. It creates new coral. Once a year that happens, and it's always on a full moon. Sorry to turn this into a TED talk, but... Just making the point that I'm not here to diss the moon. I love the moon. A lot of respect for the moon. Me and my mates, we're at the pub. We go to another pub. We're walking. On that walk, I'm the one that's like, look at the moon looks cool tonight, doesn't it? I'm the one that cares. No one else gives a shit. Not dissing the moon. I just don't like humans. I just think that it's a bit arrogant of humans to be like, yeah, we understand the moon. We get it. We've figured it all out. All the complexities of life, we figured it all out based on the moon. Yeah, we can analyse this to enough detail, enough precision, to the point where we can be like, when was he? May 28th? He's not going to be good at resolving conflict. What the fuck? How can you be so sure of something like that? I went on a date with a woman a while ago and she had an app on her phone. She had an astrology app and she asked me all these questions. She was asking me all my stats. She was like, when were you born? Where was the moon? Where were the stars? Was there a rainbow? What else was going on? Etc. Etc. And I told her all my answers and she put in all my data on her phone. And then she put in all her stats alongside it. And then she looked at me and she said, oh my God, Lewis, we're actually highly, highly compatible. I was like, that's weird, because the fact that you've just checked that makes us incompatible. Like, that thing says 80% compatible, but way more than 20% of me thinks you're a fuckwit now, so the numbers don't add up. I bumped into her recently. I bumped into her on the street, and I said hi to her. I was like, hey, what's been going on? How have you been? And she said this is true. She said to me, oh my God, it's so weird to see you today. Guess what happened in my dream last night? I said, what happened? She said, I was skydiving, right? And then I leaned up against the tram stop. I said, do go on. Tell me more. Tell me more. Tell me more. One day at work, at the school, something happened that made me feel insecure about the way that I look. I had this incident that happened that made me feel insecure about the way that I look. I was walking around the school early one morning. The kids hadn't really arrived yet. They're starting to arrive in dribs and drabs. But They haven't come out to play. It's like, it's very early in the morning, right? And I'm walking around doing like this risk assessment, checking, oh, you know, is all the ground all good? Yeah, that's all sweet. Yeah, the playground's all safe, et cetera, et cetera. And I look over, had this thing happen that made me feel insecure about the way that I look. I look over and I see a guy sitting by the playground, and he doesn't look like a parent. He looks like maybe he's been sleeping rough and maybe he's a bit disorientated. And I realize I'm going to have to ask this guy to leave because the kids are about to come out onto this playground. And that's a bit of an awkward interaction to have. So I'm feeling a bit nervous about it. I'm walking over and I'm thinking, this is could be a bit awkward. But I'm also thinking, as I walk towards him, I'm also thinking, I'm capable of having this conversation. It's Wednesday morning. I'm in my most professional mode. You know, I'm about to look after kids. I'm professional Lewis. I can have a conversation like this. It's not Saturday night, two pingers deep Lewis. It's Wednesday morning, about to look after kids Lewis. I can have a conversation like this. And that's what I'm thinking to myself as I walk towards him. I'm a professional. I get to about 20 metres from him. He looks up, he sees me, takes me in for a second, and then he yells out. He says this, he goes, yes, it is payday, and yes, you can have a cigarette. That's the vibe I give off when I'm at work. What have you got, man? I'll take anything. I am desperate. You got a bong? But then, after that happened, I analysed why he yelled that out. I overanalysed that. I do that with a lot of things. I was like, why? What was it about my appearance that made him yell that out at that time? I was thinking, I've got a bit of a mullet. I was like, maybe that had something to do with it. People have connotations about mullets. I'm going to get rid of this mullet. I don't really feel right about having a mullet. It's a weird thing, but I don't really feel like I've earned the right to have a mullet.
No, you haven't.
Thank you. I mean, you did just reiterate the thing that I just said before that, but still good input. Good. Anytime you agree with a joke, don't laugh. Just say, yeah, that's true. I agree with that. I'd like to minimize the laughter and up the good point. That's absolutely right. That's the reaction I'm looking for every time I tell a joke. I don't feel like I've earned the right to have a mullet. I grew up middle class. When I was younger, I feel like mullets were more of a working class thing. They were more of a working class thing. I feel like they've been bastardized by a different class of people. And now everyone just has them. They're trendy. People are rocking them. I feel a bit uncomfortable about it. Like, people are always talking about cultural appropriation. No one really talks about class appropriation. But go to Fitzroy. Rich people are dressing up like they're poor. Have you noticed that? They love it. It's the trendy fashion. That's what they wear now. Poor people are going into op shops like, fuck, everything's gone. They're sold out. It's cool to look like that. It's happened so quickly as well. Like, a while ago, I would go into a pub. There's four or more people with mullets. I'd be like, ah, this could be the wrong pub. I go into a pub now. There's four or more people with mullets. I'm like, ah, I bet this is also a record store or something like that. You know, I bet they make kombucha out the back. That's how quickly that's changed. I feel sorry for someone who's missed that transition. Like, imagine Jono. Jono's been in jail for 15 years. He just got out and everything's changed so much. He walks out, everything's so different now. Maybe he goes to his local pub in Brunswick that he used to drink at before it was gentrified. He's walking around and everything's changed. He goes out into the smokers area, but then he sees a guy with a mullet, a beard, neck tats, a fucking Harley Davidson t-shirt, ripped jeans and secondhand Doc Martens, and he thinks to himself, this is one of my people. I know what they look like. So he walks over to him, he smacks him on the back. He goes, hey brother, how you going? What's your name? What's your story? And the guy goes, my name's Lachlan. I went to Xavier College. If you ever touch me again, my dad will sue you. You junky piece of shit. Jono's like, whoa, this is pretty full on. Everything's changed so much. Maybe I should just go home and watch a movie. Where's the nearest Video Easy? And then he goes home. He's probably feeling sad about it. He probably goes to bed, still feeling sad. Wakes up the next morning, probably still feeling quite sad, a bit nostalgic possibly. He probably thinks to himself, you know what? I'm going to go to my old school. I'm going to go sit in my old school and reflect on the good old days before I went to jail. So he does that. He goes down to his old school and he sits down by the playground. He's having a pensive moment, minding his own business. He sees another guy with a mullet and a beard walking towards him. He thinks to himself, you know what? This time I'm going to get on the front foot. I'm going to say something nice to him before he has the chance to ridicule me. So he yells out. He goes, yeah, hey, mate, it is payday. You can have a cigarette if you'd like a cigarette. And then he gets criticised for not having eco-friendly cigarette filters on him. Like, fuck, How was he to know? Kids, a lot of the time, so when you're working with kids, sometimes, every now and then, especially with primary school age kids, every now and then they'll say something and you're like, whoa, that's crazy that you just said that. A lot of the time, you're filtering through stuff that has no effect. Like, you could hear it or not hear it and it wouldn't change your life at all. Do you know what I mean? I thought Spider-Man was going to die in the last movie. I don't give a fuck, mate. There's a lot of that. Sometimes when I eat tiny teddies, my teeth hurt. Cool. Every now and then, amidst all of that, like a needle in a haystack, a kid will say something and you're like, that's fucking crazy, actually. That's really impressive that you've even had that thought. I was playing Jenga with a kid about a week and a half ago, playing Jenga with this kid. He's 6 years old. Imagine you at six saying this. We're playing Jenga, six-year-old kid. He goes to me, looks at me and just goes, if the blocks are all the same size, how come some of them bear weight and some don't? I said, you are a fucking genius, mate. I have no idea. I don't know. Not only do I not know, I've never asked myself that question. That's incredible critical thinking. I am so impressed. But kids are also, they're smart and dumb simultaneously. That's what's really amazing. That same kid later that day, he's very smart. He was explaining like weather patterns to me. He's talking about atmospheric pressure, all this crazy stuff. He's 6 years old, like probably regurgitating stuff, but still, it's very impressive. Atmospheric pressure, this is how the clouds work. I'm like, this kid is a genius. But then in the same sentence, he was like, yeah, with all that atmospheric pressure, it just makes it even more impressive how Father Christmas is able to fly through that. I was like, mate, Father Christmas isn't real, you fucking idiot. I just think it's crazy that you can say something like that and then quickly chat. Like if I had said to that kid, that Jenga thing, that is so intelligent. But if I had said to him, oh, it's because the aliens make the blocks and they make them all like this weird, out of this weird potion, that makes them bear weight differently. He would have been like, okay, sweet, okay, fair enough. You know, he's smart enough to have that thought, but not smart enough to question. Remember the first few years of your life, adults say stuff and you're just like, that's how it is. You don't question, you don't realise that adults are capable of lying. I convinced a few kids at work, there's chickens at the school that I work at. I convinced them that I could speak to the chickens. 6 years old, 7 years old, an hour of the day, just going, brak, brak. It's incredible, isn't it? The kids are going, wow, this is amazing. Sometimes I'd go, brak, brak, and the chicken would coincidentally make a noise straight after my noise. And it'd actually look like we were conversing. I was like, this is so good. And the kids would be like, wow, oh my God. Other times, I'd go, brak, brak, and the chicken wouldn't make any noise. And I'd sort of be like, oh no, I've probably blown my cover here. But the kids are just like, oh, the chicken didn't like what you said then. They've gone all quiet now. First few years of your life, adults say stuff and you're like, that's true, that's how it is. Then there's a moment where an adult says something to you and you're like, hold on a second, that's not real, that's not true. And I think that's a big moment of growing up. I remember when I had that realization that adults can lie. I was at the Adelaide Zoo, I was 7 years old or thereabouts, and I'm at the Adelaide Zoo. I grew up in Adelaide, I'm at the Adelaide Zoo and I'm looking at the leopard enclosure. The leopard enclosure at the Adelaide Zoo is quite small, and the leopard in there is just pacing round and round in circles for ages, and it didn't look good. And I went over to the zookeeper and I was like, hey man, I'm just wondering. I doubt I said hey man when I was seven. I doubt I was that confident. But I said something to the effect of, is that leopard okay? It looks kind of sad. What's going on with that leopard? And the zookeeper said this to me. He said, no, it's all good. Don't worry about it. All sweet. Because leopards are actually a pacing animal, naturally. So if you went, they just pace all the time. If you went to Africa right now, you'd see heaps of leopards just pacing round and round in circles. I was like, mate, I know I'm only 7 years old, but I've lived those 7 years in Adelaide. I can recognise boredom-induced psychosis when I see it. Seen it all my life, mate. That's just a random zookeeper. That doesn't matter that much. But then realising your parents can lie. Like, I was so late to realise Father Christmas wasn't real, like that kid, because I just couldn't believe that my parents would lie to me. Parents used to say whatever they wanted, and I'd just be like, that's the truth. That's how it is. I got 50 cents under my pillow the first time I ever lost a tooth. And I remember being a bit of a brat about it. I was like, ah, some kid's got a dollar. Some kid's got $2. One kid got a $5 note. I was like, Mum, why did I only... This is bullshit. Mum said, oh, I'm really sorry. The Tooth Fairy made bad investments this week. I didn't know what an investment was, but I was like, wow, that's such a shame. I feel sorry for the Tooth Fairy. I hope she's okay. We used to drive from Adelaide to Melbourne quite often. On that drive, there's a big koala near Horsham. It's like the big banana, big guitar, big koala, right? It's probably not as famous as either of those two. It's a bit dilapidated, if I'm totally honest with you. Next time you drive past it, think about me telling you this now. It's not, doesn't look like a koala, I'll say that much. It looks like a weird sort of monster. It's about 15 metres high. It's got a kiosk built into its bladder. It's a very strange looking structure. My parents used to tell me every time we did that drive that it was a real koala, and the reason it never moved was because it was just sleeping every time. It had huge glass eyes, they were red, and they were staring like this. Fucked up my perception of animals. I remember thinking to myself, wow, animals are so weird. Horses sleep standing up, koalas sleep with their eyes like that, and a kiosk open. And then you get a bit older, you realise that adults can lie, your parents can lie, and then you get into that age, those formative years, and that's when you can be influenced by so many things, you start to have heroes, and you start being able to have interesting conversations. Lately, in the last few months, I've been working in, the school that I work at is a prep to 12 school, and I've been working in the high school part of the school. Up until then, mostly been in the primary school, last couple months in the high school part. With those age kids, it's such a different job. Like, obviously the kids are very different, but the job itself. I just want to give you a quick synopsis of my first day working in the high school part of the school. So in primary school, you know, teacher's aide. I'm like sort of just helping out in the classroom, just doing random odd jobs, helping the kids out. Oh, you know, this one can't spell this word. This one's punching that one. We've got to stop that. This one's crying for some reason. This one's shit himself. Like, there's like all these different things. You're jumping around a lot, you know? You're quite busy jumping around. High school, obviously, very different. First day, didn't really know what to expect. Looked on my roster. Okay, it's year 10 science. I'm going in there. Okay, I go into the room. I'm supporting a kid who's in a wheelchair. We're sitting at the back of the room. But if anything, he knows more about science than me. We're sitting at the back of the room. The science teacher's at the front. I say, hey, mate, how's it going? All right, let's do the lesson. The teacher's sort of giving the lesson. I'm sitting there. I don't really know what my job is at this point. At this point, I'm kind of just doing year 10 science. Started really enjoying it. I felt like Billy Madison. I was like, this is pretty interesting, actually. Am I allowed to answer some of these? He said it was sedimentary. I reckon it's igneous, that one, to be honest. Went to Chinese after science. That was great. Chinese teacher's explaining fortune cookies to us. She's like, fortune cookies started because there was a dictatorship in China. And at the time, all the revolutionaries wrote down these little messages, hid them inside biscuits, gave them out. In the messages it said, tonight, meet here. We're going to overthrow this dictatorship. That's the origin of fortune cookies. The teacher's explaining this. Half the kids are on their phones. I'm like, guys, this is fucking sick. Listen up. If this was a podcast, people would pay for it. This is cool as. We had drama at the end of the day. Went to the drama class. That was a great lesson. A bit of a bludge, but great subject. One of my favourite subjects. Always has been one of my favourite. That was the subject where I was like, maybe I'm in too deep with this high school thing. I got too into it. I was really acting, really performing in the drama class. I'm with the kid that I'm supporting. We have to learn a scene from Pinocchio and then perform it to the rest of the class, right? And we did that. We learnt it, practised it, performed it to the rest of the class. Absolutely killed it. Whatever. Not important. Who cares? The teacher said that, though. He was like, that was really good, guys. And this is when I realised I was in too deep, because the teacher gave us all this praise. He was like, that was fantastic. Really well done. Great. The voices you used, the bits of improv. Bloody good job. Really well done, guys. And I felt quite good about that. But then I realised the whole time he was giving us that praise, he was looking at the kid and not at me. And I thought to myself, fuck you. If he shone, it's because I let him shine. I had that thought inside my head. How ridiculous. But it's cool working with kids that age, year 7, 8, 9, 10, because you can have interesting conversations with them in a way that you can't really do with the younger kids. Like, you can have interesting chats about the world. They're watching things. They're engaging with the world. I was talking to this girl recently, year 8 girl, about favourite movies. Had an interesting conversation. Tell me if you think this is weird. She was telling me that her favourite movie is, I don't know what it's called, but it's like the Ted Bundy movie. It's about Ted Bundy. Yeah, I was like, that's a bit crook, I reckon. Like, why is that your favourite movie? You're in year 8. Why are you even watching that movie? Why is that your favourite movie? She was like, it's got Zac Efron in it. I love him. But yeah, but it's America's Worst Serial Killer. It's not fucking High School Musical. I don't think you should be watching that. And I started giving her a lecture. I started saying, why are you engaging with this shit? When I was your age, I didn't even watch that many movies. I used to watch Obama give speeches. He was my hero. I love that guy. I used to go home after school, watch Obama give inspiring speeches. That's what I was doing when I was 13. You should reassess the stuff that you're engaging with at your age. Kids are too smart these days. They're too informed. She looked at me, she listened to my little lecture, she looked at me and she said, Obama's killed way more people than Ted Bundy though. Fuck! Now I have to go home and reevaluate my hero because of a 13-year-old girl. I'm at home, I'm Googling it. What's he done? Why'd she say that? What's he done? Heaps of shit. He's done heaps. He's done heaps. I'm Googling it. 964. That's the number. That's the number they're giving me. Obama's drone strikes killed 964 innocent civilians. That's a big number, isn't it? I'm Googling, how many people did Ted Bundy kill? 36. Fuck, she's got a point, doesn't she? She's got a pretty good point. I want to assure you, I'm not about to go into something where I like try to convince you that Barack Obama's a worse person than Donald Trump or something like that. That's ridiculous. That's stupid. I would never try to convince you of that. But I am going to try and convince you that he's worse than Ted Bundy. Because 964 is so much more than 36. They're vastly different numbers. It's 928 more, to be precise. I know that because I've been doing year 10 maths, smashing it, whatever. If there was a fantasy football league for murderers, you get murderers on your team, the more murders they've done, the better they are as a player. If you got Ted Bundy on your team, your friends would laugh at you. In the group chat, they'd be like, what the fuck are you doing, mate? 36? He's shit house. Get Obama. He's a silent killer. You can get him at a good price. He flies under the radar, puts up good, consistent numbers. You could build a team around a guy like that. Get a few more stars in there. Get Hitler on a wing. Pol Pot on another. Ivan Milat down back. He doesn't have the best numbers, but he plays with a lot of heart, doesn't he? Puts his head over the ball. That's for sure. Some people don't like this comparison, but let's go back to school. They were at school. We're hanging out at school. There's a bully at the school. They bash 36 kids. They suck, right? Oh, they bash 36 kids. They're the worst. I hate them. I'm not trying to convince you otherwise. They are definitely shit. But then, what if there's another bully who also happens to be the principal of the school? And they pay all the teachers to fly these little robotic planes around bashing 964 kids. Who's worse? It's obvious, isn't it? He's got a Nobel Peace Prize. Isn't that weird? 964 is quite a big number to have a prize that's got the word peace in it. That doesn't really seem... I think that's a bit strange, isn't it? I think we should strip him of that award. Or give Ted Bundy one, because 36 is fuck all comparatively. If that's the metric... That kids died in the drone strikes. This is what I'm Googling. This is what I'm figuring out. Holy shit, kids died in Obama's drone strikes. That's my hero. That's the guy I idolized when I was a kid. Now I'm finding out because of a kid that that guy has killed kids. Imagine that, sitting on the computer. What the fuck? What's real? My hero's wrong. My hero's false. I was thinking about the kids that died in those drone strikes. I was thinking about, there was probably a kid just like me. There was probably a little half-deaf kid, you know, running around, listening to his iPod. Hey, what's up? What's
going on? Is this the real life?
Kicking the soccer ball. One of his friends is like, hey, mate, what's that up in the sky? What's that up there? I don't know.
Open your eyes. Look up to the skies.
I haven't seen anything like it. It could be Father Christmas, though, hopefully. I know this is a predominantly Muslim country, but some people believe in Christmas. I personally believe in Christmas, quite excited about Christmas, looking forward to it. This kid's a bit older, they're in year 8, year 9. They're like, mate, I don't think that's Father Christmas. Father Christmas isn't real. I'm pretty sure that's a drone. No, Father Christmas is real. Mum said Father Christmas is real. Mum doesn't lie. Adults don't even lie. I'm not even old enough to have realised that adults lie yet. To be honest, the biggest problem in my life right now is Lego trains. I'm not old enough to have to think about a drone. Mum said Father Christmas is real. She wouldn't lie about that, would you, Mum? Mum, that's Father Christmas, isn't it, Mum? Mum. 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 Don't look at me, I didn't do it. Thanks for coming. Fuck. Bit full on for a comedy show, isn't it? On a Thursday. How's the comedian? Was he funny? I don't know. He did this drone strike thing. It's quite strange. But I think it's important. It's important because I feel like that was my final stage of growing up. That girl teaching me that Obama wasn't who I thought he was, that was like my final stage of growing up. Because at one stage in my life, I was a young kid, all I cared about was Lego trains, got a bit older, I realised adults can lie, that broke something down. And then I realised my parents can lie, that broke something else down. And then finally, at this late stage in my life, this girl taught me that even my hero lied, even the hero that I held so high, even he lies, even he's flawed. And that's what I love about working with kids. They cause you to reflect on your own life and your own childhood. And I had a very lucky, privileged, happy childhood. That girl reminded me that it's not like that for some kids. A lot of kids it's not like that for. And I started getting annoyed about it. I started thinking, I want to change the world. I want to fix the world. And I'm going to do it. I'm just going to fucking do something drastic. I'm sick of the world being so unfair, sick of the world having so many problems in it. I'm going to save the world. And I did that day. I went down to my local smoke mart. I got a packet of these. These are called eco-friendly. They're a bit more expensive, but it's worth it. They're actually shit. Don't get them. They suck. Before I go, thank you. I'm going to tell you one more story. But thank you so much for coming. There's like four nights left of the comedy festival. Go to, there's so many good shows. Just go, just have a browse. See what tickles your fancy. Sometimes I recommend people, but I can't be fucked tonight. I can't think of anyone. They're all good. There's heaps of good ones. Just go to heaps of shit. Thank you for coming to my show. I'm going to tell you, before I leave, I'd like to tell you the best thing I've ever seen working in childcare. I don't want to leave you on that drone strike thing. I'd like to juxtapose it with something nice. This is the best thing I've ever seen working with kids, and perhaps the best thing I've ever seen in my life, full stop. A few years ago, I was working at a summer camp in America, and we had a reptile guy come in. We all know, we've been to school, we've seen a reptile guy. You know, they come in, they show the kids the reptiles. Sometimes not just reptiles, not exclusively. Sometimes they'll have an echidna or something. But you still think of them as a reptile guy, and you're not like, oh, that's the animal guy. Anyway, I digress. This guy came into the summer camp and he had all these reptiles and he was going to show all the kids all these reptiles. He comes in. They're always the same, aren't they? They always dress like Steve Irwin, a bit socially awkward. You always get the sense that they get along better with animals than humans. He was just like that. But he was American though, so even more exaggerated. Imagine that, but even weirder sort of thing. Anyway, he gets there and he's doing this talk. There's about 100 kids all sitting on these big steps and then we're looking down at him. He's on the grass and he starts giving the reptile talk. He starts with the lizards, which they always start with. That's interesting, I reckon. That's like showmanship. They know the lizards is the most boring. Build up, get a bit more venomous, a bit more dangerous, finish on the croc. That's your big closer. It's interesting that they're aware of that sort of, that showmanship aspect of what they do. They're not just animal people. They know how to play a crowd. Isn't that interesting? There's always, like, no kids care about the lizard part. They're always watching the lizards like, fuck off, mate. We've seen a blue tongue. Who cares? There's always one kid, though, during the lizard part that's really into it. They're like, whoa, is that a gecko? What is that? And that's the kid that grows up to be a reptile guy. Anyway, he's doing that. He's talking about the lizards. He gets to the snakes, and the snakes is more exciting. He's got a big sack. He's like, I've got two snakes in here. One of them is just a basic, boring carpet python. He didn't say boring. I inferred that. But it's just a classic, stock standard sort of snake. The other one is a rare exotic snake. I can't remember what it was called, but you can tell by the way he's talking about that exotic one that he fucking loves this snake. He absolutely loves it. I knew straight away something had gone wrong. I saw, he opened the sack, right? I saw something had gone wrong. His face changed so drastically. He's talking about the snake. He's like, I love this snake. It was injured when I first got it. He was like, they travel together sometimes, these two snakes. They, you know, that's all good. Don't worry about it. I sort of had a moment where I was like, interesting. They travel together. I wonder what's going on. He opened the sack. His face changed so drastically. He did that thing. I thought this was just from cartoons where you're like, you're fine. And then you look down at the thing, you look back up and your face has changed. I didn't think that was a real life thing. He did that proper cartoon. He was like, all right, so I'm just going to grab out the snake. I was like, whoa, what's going on in that sack? He starts pulling out the carpet python and it's writhing around. He's pulling it out by the tail. As he pulls it out, we see the carpet python is biting down on the head of the snake that he loves. It's like clasped on to the skull of the exotic snake that he loves. And the snake he loves is just so clearly dead. Yeah, I don't know if you've ever seen a dead snake before, but there's something quite sad about a dead snake, deflated, defeated. If you've ever seen a flaccid penis at a time when you don't want that penis to be flaccid, it's a very similar feeling that it evokes. So he's going through all that. He doesn't know what to do. Also, his daughter's there. I think he was sort of chaperoning her, teaching her how to be a reptile person or whatever. So he says to her, he's like, can you take over for a second while I deal with this dead snake? She comes over. She's like, all right, this is a turtle. No one cares. He's over here. Everyone's just like, what the fuck's going on with that dead snake? The kids have started noticing. There's a dead snake. Why is the snake dead? What's going on? It's not moving. What's happening over there? I'm sitting next to this kid, William. He's 8 years old. He's yelling at the guy. He stood up. He's going, why don't you keep them in separate enclosures? Fucking oath, William. You should do that. You're a smart kid. You'll go far. You're absolutely right. He pulls the snakes apart, he puts the carpet python back, and then he's just holding his dead snake. I can see the gears working in his brain. I see him think this to himself. I see him think, if I don't try it, I'll regret it for the rest of my life. He starts giving the snake mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. That's incredible, isn't it? I never thought I'd see that with my eyes. A human giving mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. Just visualise that for a second. Amazing. His daughter's still going, so the turtle has four things. The kids are like, who gives a shit? He's kissing a snake. That's gross. Why is he kissing it? He's pumping air into it. It looked like he was blowing up a balloon, to be honest. About 5 minutes, he's pumping air into it. And then he crouches down like this and he says to his daughter, all right, I'm going to come back over. And he walks over, holds his arm up, and the snake is just slowly winding its way around his arm. He's revived it and brought it back to life. He's crying. His daughter starts hugging him. All the kids stand up. He's getting a standing ovation. They're going, yes, yes. I'm going, fuck yeah, brother. No one cares about swearing in front of the kids. It's all good. Do what you want. School's out forever. He starts giving a speech. He's like, this is what can happen if you believe. Most beautiful thing I've ever seen in my life. Doesn't have a punchline, that story, because it's just a true story. I don't want to dirty that story by tagging on a punchline to it. I think it should just belong on its own. So you have to leave this show without a big laugh at the end. I'm sorry about that. Enjoy the rest of your night. Have a good one. See you later. Thanks for coming.
Is this the real life? Is this just fantasy? Caught in a landslide, no escape from reality.